All right, what three should we do together? Okay, so if the minimum speed is 40, the maximum speed is 60, does that mean we've got a and, like x can be this and that, or it can only be this or that? Can it be above 60 and below, above 40 and below 60? You can't. So 40, does 40 need to be, like x is our speed, it varies, it changes, right? But we need to keep it between two speeds. So does 40 need to be greater than, or does it need to be less than?
It needs to be less than.
Less than. Can it be equal to? Can
yes.
it go 40? Yeah, it just says the minimum speed. You have to go at least 40. So our speed, x, is greater than 40. But x also needs to be less than or equal to 60. Okay? So between 40 and 60, if we were to graph it, stand to be a little less slanted than that. So, there's 0 plus 40. If that's 40, our scale would be that. Maybe that could be 40, and then this would be about 60. So we can drive 40, we can drive 60, we can drive less than 60, we can drive more than 40. And there they all are, all the points that are bigger than 40 and less than 60. Number 7, now 10.
Solve this inequality.
Well, this looks kind of funny, right? Because this is, what's bigger, negative 7 or negative 12? What's bigger, negative 7 or negative 12?
Negative 12. Well, negative 7.
Right, negative 7, right? It's more to the right of the number line. So this is written kind of funny because the bigger numbers on the left and the smaller numbers on the right. Is that all right? I mean, well, the smaller number may be on the right, but what does the sign say?
That
the smaller number needs to be on the smaller side. It's going to be less, right? So it's just kind of written backwards. That's okay, I guess. We could also rewrite it. Certainly not part of the problem that we have to do, but we can rewrite it. And now it kind of looks like it flows a little better. And the smaller numbers on the left, the bigger numbers on the right, it doesn't matter. It's all the same. We might as well work with the way it looked to start with. All right, so we need to figure out what y is. Remember that we're just solving two inequalities simultaneously. We're solving that one, right? At the same time that we're solving this one. Solve them all at once by, well, what would we do to get y by itself here?
Add 8.
So we'd add 8 to both sides, right? But there's like 3 sides, quote, unquote, 3 sides. If I was solving this inequality, I would add 8 to both sides. If I was solving this inequality, I would add 8 to both sides. So we add it to all 3 sides, all expressions. Negative 7 plus 8 is 1. That needs to be the largest number, then y comes in between 1 and this other smaller number. Negative 12 plus 8 is negative 4. So y needs to be larger than or equal to negative 4, but also less than 1. It still makes logical sense even though it's written kind of in reverse. It still works. So y is less than 1, greater than negative 4. That's number 10. 15. This is an or inequality. 2r plus 3 needs to be less than 7. Or negative r plus 9 needs to be less than or equal to 2. So we'll solve this inequality, then we'll solve that other inequality. So what are we going to do first to solve this inequality?
Subtract 3 from both sides.
Subtract 3 from both sides. Now we have 2r equals 4. Now what's less than 4?
Then you divide by 2.
Divide by 2. R is less than 2 for length 2 and length 2. Now, solve this inequality.
How will we do it?
Subtract 9 from this.
Subtract 9, so we'll get negative R is less than or equal to negative 7. So subtract 9 from 2, negative 7.
And then you divide by negative 1.
Divide by negative 1. So we get R, what?
Is less than or equal to 7.
We divide it by a negative, we divide by a negative.
Positive.
You flip the signs.
Right. So we get a positive R is greater than or equal to 7. Remember, flip the sign when you divide both sides by a negative or multiply both sides by a negative.
So it's just dividing, like if you multiply both sides by a negative?
You would, still. You would still flip the sign.
Because
the thing is, the R here, the variable has a negative in front of it. Like it's already multiplied by a negative. So if I want this guy here to be less than negative 7, okay, think about it. Like, I want a number that's less than, right? So I want numbers, like, when we talk about inequalities, we're talking about values that you go on forever, right? To infinity sometimes. Okay. Well, we want this expression here to be less than, right? So we want to allow this to go way off to the left, right? Way off to the left. Well, there's already a negative in front of it. What kind of numbers are way off to the left for all eternity?
Negative
numbers, right? There's a negative in front of it. So the actual values that I want for R. Do I want to plug in negative numbers for R? No, because what happens when I multiply a negative by a negative?
Positive.
The positive numbers, right? So if I were to be plugging in big old negative numbers, right? Like negative 100, negative 12,000, then when they get multiplied by a negative, that would actually turn them into a big positive number, which means my numbers that I actually get would be going up in that direction. So the actual values I want to plug in for R are actually all these big positive numbers. R going to the big positive number, so that when I plug them in and multiply by a negative, it actually goes in the direction I want it to go. So, for this part of it, if we're at 7, and R is greater than 7, or equal to 7, if that happens, then when we plug it in here, and it gets multiplied by a negative, now it's less than. Now it's going to be less than. And then we have 2 right there. It cannot be equal to 2, so we'll put an open circle there, and we'll shade everywhere to the left. It needs to be less than 2. Well, those are 3 examples. You guys have any questions about solving compound inequalities? If you can solve an inequality, then you can solve a compound inequality. Either you're going to have an OR compound inequality, which is just like 2 problems in one. You just solve 2 inequalities, this one first and that one over there. Or you have an AND compound inequality, which we write like this. And then anything we do to this expression to get the variable by itself, we'll do to the right expression and the left expression so that everything stays in the same relationship that it started. They're not equal, then all those things will stay. This will stay larger, this will stay smaller, if we make sure to give it to all of the expressions at once. If you have trouble with that, we'll just break it up into 2 different inequalities. This inequality, and instead of OR, we have AND this inequality, y minus 8 is greater than or equal to negative 12. If you'd rather do that, ready to pass it in and take a little review. Pass it in and put everything away. Alright, so we have an AND inequality. This expression needs to be between 2 values. So we're just going to concentrate here on the expression with x in it and get x by itself. So, what would we do to get x by itself? Subtract 5. So you get 15, needs to be less than or equal to negative 3x, which is less than 33. We would
divide by three.
Divide by three?
What's negative three?
Negative. Divided by a negative. Dividing by a negative. Okay. Imagine just for a second that I was just solving this inequality here. When I divide by this negative 3, what would I do? You get x. 15 divided by negative 3 would be negative 5. But when I divide by a negative?
You gotta flip the signs.
You flip this sign right here, you would turn it into this situation, right? So that's what we need to do. We need to do that for both of the inequalities, right? When we divide this by negative 3, this becomes negative 11. And so this needs to be, right, flipped around. Does that make sense? Can x be greater than negative 11 and less than or equal to negative 5? Yeah, negative 11 is more to the left. This is kind of written in reverse, right? It's kind of written backwards. This means the same thing as negative 11 needs to be less than x, needs to be less than or equal to negative 5. Between negative 11 and negative 5, it's something we can do. If we didn't do that, let's think about how that wouldn't make a lot of sense. We didn't switch the signs. We would get negative 5 is less than or equal to x, which is less than negative 11. Could x be greater than negative 5 and less than negative 11?
Less than, yes.
What's the number that's greater than negative 5? Just name one.
4.
Negative
4?
Negative 4 is greater. Okay. Is negative 4 less than negative 11?
No.
So it failed, right? It can't be less. It can't be greater than negative 5 and less than negative 11. Because let's look at what that means. Here's negative 11 over here, more to the left than negative 5. Here's negative 4, it's bigger than negative 5, right? It's over here. But it's not less than negative 11, and it never could be. So if we start out with this expression that needs to be between two values, between 20 and 38, then it needs to end being between two values. It needs to make sense. That's why we need to remember to switch the sign and divide by a negative. Remember, divide by negative. Or multiply or divide both sides by negative, then we switch the sign. Okay. Make sure you have our notes out. See, you need to get out of this. Open it up.
All the good stuff.
Okay, so now we're going to graph linear inequalities in two variables. We've done it in one variable, it's just on a number line. Now we're going to do it in two variables, which is a lot like graphing a line. Okay. So, like x is greater than or equal to 5. That's easy enough. This is in one variable. Here's 0. Here's 5. And so x can be anything over here. What if I said like x plus y needs to be greater than or equal to 5? Alright, so what can x
be? It would be 3 and 2.
Okay, 3 and 2 is a combination that works. 3 comma 2 works.
Or 4 and 1.
4 and 1.
Oh, God.
How about 1 and 4?
Yeah.
That's different, right? Now x is 1 and y.
Basically, that's it.
5 and 0.
1 and 1.
5 and 0.
0 and 5.
0 and 5.
2 and 3.
2 and 3.
3 and 2.
Got 3 and 2.
You just do 1 and 1.
But 1 plus 1 is...
equal to?
So we need 3,
wait.
1 and 1.
Okay. 1 and 1?
Greater than or equal to, right?
Yeah, greater than or equal to.
So 6 and 1. and 1.
6 and 0.
8 and 9.
6 and 0, 8 and
9. So anything above 5.
Anything above 5. So how many possibilities are there?
A lot.
How many a lot is it?
Infinite.
Infinite number. These are just whole numbers. Mm-hmm. And these are just positive numbers. Even if I wanted to equal 5, how about negative 1 and 6?
1,000 and 1 billion.
1,000 and 1 billion, and you've just started to scratch the surface of possibilities for X and Y. Right?
3 trillion.
There's just tons. There's too many. There's an infinite number. There's no limit to how many possibilities there are. Let's take a look here. Okay. We have two variables. So one number line is not enough. We have to have two number lines. We have to be able to show at the same time what x is and what y is. Right?
No question.
Yeah.
So like if there's infinite numbers, like that goes on forever.
There are.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then what it's like after quadrillion.
Okay. Are you just asking for the name of a number that's after quadrillion?
No.
Yeah, it's like, what's the next thing?
Well, we can keep naming them, but I mean, that doesn't put a limitation on numbers. Even if there was a number that was the biggest number that had an official name,
okay,
you add one to it, and now I'm just a number that's bigger.
I don't know, but then what's after that? Like, you know, like 100.
You're getting on bottom line,
the thousands.
What's the name of it?
Yes.
It doesn't matter what the name is, it exists. We could just arbitrarily say, okay, we got quadrillion, right? That's going to be, so we got 1,000.
Yeah.
And we got millions.
Yeah.
And we got billions.
Yeah.
We got trillions.
Okay.
That's where we come on to quadrillions.
Alright.
Whether or not this next thing has a name or not, it doesn't matter, but we could call it pentillions. This could be sectillions, septillions, octillions, nontillions, dectillions. And then maybe after we get past dectillions, I don't know, what do we call it?
I should come up with names for all of them.
That would be a full-time job for every person on Earth for the rest of eternity.
Oh.
That would keep everybody employed. There'd be no more unemployment. Everybody on Earth could have the same job, which is coming up with names for the next biggest number, and then nobody would ever be out of work for all of eternity.
I think people would get in fights over it. It's like, no, this should be the name. It's like, no, this should be the name.
There's just so many numbers. There are numbers, there's like single numbers, individual numbers, that get used for a particular proof that are just way bigger than any number that is really feasible. But they get special names, like Graham's number is a number that's it's a very large number, it has a particular name, it used to hold the world record for the biggest number that was used in a mathematical proof. And it got a name, it was called Graham's number because the guy's name was Graham who used it, but that's the only reason it has that name.
Do you know the number?
It escapes me. I don't even know. I can't even, it uses a special notation called arrow notation, and I don't even remember
how many zeros I have.
How that notation even works. Like there are notations like 5 to the third. That notation means 5 times 5 times 5. There's this thing called arrow notation where 5 arrow 3 would mean like, just ridiculously bigger than 5 to the third. But it has to do with exponents, and I can't remember how it works.
Can you show us?
We could later.
Yeah.
Well, let's look at all these possibilities that we just rattled off. We got 3, 2. X is 3 and Y is 2. So X is 3 and Y is 2. 4 and 1. Here's 4 and here's 1. 1 and 4. We're going to start to see some kind of a shape take place here. 5, 0. 0, 5. We got 0, 4, 5, 6, 7, 2, 3. Okay. Negative 1, 6. There's 6 right there.
Yep.
What are you starting to see?
It's all going in a straight line.
It's going in a straight line.
It's going into a negative straight line.
It has a negative slope. Slope of negative 1. That's not a big surprise because this is just the line you would get if you had the equation x plus y equals 5. And equals 5 is fine. That's part of the possibilities. Right? I could rewrite this equation as, wait a second, y equals negative x plus 5 if I subtract x from both sides. And now I have an equation where this is the what? On the graph?
Y-intercept.
It's the point on the y-axis where the line crosses. And this guy right here, negative 1 over 1, what's that?
1.
That's the slope.
We go to the right one and down one, Okay, those are all the possibilities for when the number that is in the place of x and the number that is in the place of y add together, and we get 5. But we also have every other combination of numbers where they don't equal 5, but instead they are what? When you add them together, we get what kind of number?
An inequal.
In what way? They're not equal to what?
They're not equal to 5.
They're not equal to 5, which means that they're either bigger than 5 or smaller than 5. What are they?
3 and 5. That work bigger than 5.
Bigger than 5 is what we're looking for. 3 and 5 work. 3 for x and 5 for y would make a number that is bigger than 5 when you add them together. Let's look at those. We'll plot those. 6, 1. There's one of them. 8, 9. 6, 7, 8, 9. This is 6. Oh, that's not. 6, 7. 8, 9. 8, 9. There it is up there. 6, 6, 0. 4, 5, 6, 0. 6, 1, 8, 9. 3, 5. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now these seem to be following any kind of pattern. How many points do we have that are not on the line? Counting how many points are not on the line that we've plotted. I'm not talking about philosophically. I'm the ones that we put up on the board that are not on the line. Where are they? I mean, how many are there? My question is, how many points have we plotted that are not on the line?
A lot.
Not on the face. They're up on the board.
Like a lot.
A lot.
Like two.
Huh?
Like two.
Two. Let's count them. These are on the line, right?
Yeah.
This one's not. 6, 0. This one's not. This one's not. This one's not. They're not on this line. They're not on this line.
4.
Right? 4. Yeah, so far there have been 4. Do they seem to be following kind of pattern? Are they making another line?
No. Well, 2 are.
2 of these happen to be in line. These happen to be in line. These are in a straight line. These 2 are in a straight line. Any 2 points are in a straight line. Right? Keep naming some more. Name some more possibilities for x and y that when we add them together, we're bigger than 5.
7 and 10.
Let's plot that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 10. That's 9. So this would be about 10. There's another one. Certainly does not seem to be following any kind of pattern or making any kind of shape.
3 and 4.
3 and 4. I'm going to keep plotting these points for as long as you keep naming them, until somebody says, oh, I think any of those points is going to be something, make some kind of a statement about any point that we might plot.
Okay.
Okay, keep naming.
5 and 6.
5 and 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 6. What's that? Could we do ones that have a negative value?
Yeah,
could I do one that has a negative 1?
Negative 3 and positive 9.
Negative 3 and positive 9. Let's see, negative 3.
Oh, wait, no, that would be positive 10.
Is that?
No, never mind. Yeah, negative 3.
Yeah, negative 3, positive 9.
Would that work?
Negative 3 plus 9, what's that?
5.
Negative 3 plus 9?
Oh, it would be 4.
3 plus
9
is 6.
7, 8, 6.
It is 6,
oh
and that is, that is bigger than 5, so negative 3, 9. Let's see, that's 9 right there. Negative 3, 9. If I did negative 3, 8, that would be 5, and that would be on the line.
Okay. Alright,
let's keep going.
So confused what you want us to do here.
Just keep naming points until somebody says, oh, I see. All the points that we would plot would be such and such. They would have to be.
They're on top. I can't remember what it's called, but they're on the. There's no point below.
We're not going to have any points below.
Because you go below negative, they're not going to go below
the axis.
The axis, I should say. Right? I don't know how to explain it.
Not below this axis?
Or the other one. Like, it won't go below it because then it's just going to be negative. And that's less than 5.
Let's see. How about 10, negative 1. Now, there's a negative y value. That's going to be below the axis. Is that greater than 5? 10 plus negative 1?
Yeah.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9,
sure.
10, negative 1. That works. It is below the axis. Maybe that's not what Brent's meant. Is that what you meant?
Yeah, that's close enough.
Well, that one's below the axis. These are over here. It's the left of the y-axis. This one's below the x-axis.
All right, fine.
It won't go below the line.
It won't go below this line. Well, is there evidence to support Cameron?
Yeah.
What you just said?
I can make it go below that line.
Okay, go. Do it.
Okay. 4. No, 3. And
3
and negative
so.
3.
Okay, 3 and negative 3. But 3 negative 3, let's talk about that point. 3 negative 3. Remember, it needs to make this inequality true. So let's plug in 3 and negative 3. 3 plus negative 3 is?
Let's see.
Is 0 greater than 5? No, it's not.
No,
it's not.
You can't go below 5 because then you've got less than 5.
Exactly. Right? What do all of the points on the line do?
They're on 5.
They add to 5. So anything below that, right?
We're
going to be
less
than 5.
That makes sense.
If we switch it, if I said less than, if I said less than or equal to 5, then where would all the points be?
Below
the line. Below
the
line. Very good. Yeah. So the line is like this barrier, this fence between x's and y's that make the inequality true and x's and y's that don't make the inequality true.
Yeah.
Solutions and non-solutions. Okay. So if I were to plot all of those points that work in this inequality, what would I see?
It would be above 5.
What would be above 5?
The dot.
How many dots?
All the dots above 5.
Which are how many? Infinite. So if I were to plot all the infinity points above the line, what would that start to look like?
Shaded areas.
It's just all blocked out by all of these points, right? That's how we get lines, right? We graph an infinite number of points that all just kind of mush together and make this line shape. And now with this, we wind up just plotting all these points above the line, right? Until after all infinity that we don't have in our lifetime, we would shade in an entire line. But that's an entire half of the plane.
Yeah.
So, you get all the stuff that makes it equal, and all the stuff that makes it not equal in the right way. It makes the left side with x plus y greater than 5. Okay. Let's try 2x plus y is greater than but not equal to 7. Let's come up with some combinations for this inequality to work. What's that? Am I going to divide by 2 first?
Well, don't you have 2 first?
Well, then I just get x plus what half of y. Come on, name some points that work. I'll do my part. I'll make parentheses while I wait. 14.
7, what is it?
7.
3.
Let's see, 2 times 14, what's that? 28 plus 7.
36 or
35? 35. Is 35 bigger than 7? A lot. Okay, 14. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There you go, there's one.
4, negative 1.
4, negative 1. Let's test that one out. 4, that's 8. Minus 1. Now, does that make this inequality true?
No.
It doesn't. But only just barely, right? Because what do we get when we put in a 4 here and you get 8 and subtract 1?
You get 7.
7, right? But it can't be equal to 7. But it could just be barely, like just a little bit past that, right? So what we're kind of doing is finding that fence, that barrier between points that work and points that don't, right? Once the left side is equal to 7, we know it got too far. So let's look at that point, 4, negative 1. 4, negative 1. I don't want to include that point, right? What do we draw when we want to draw a point, but we don't want to include that point?
Open circle.
Right, an open circle.
6, negative 1.
6, negative 1? 2 times 6. 2 times 6 is 12. Minus 1 is 11. That certainly works. 4, 5, 6, negative 1. That's a point that I will fill in. What's another point that just barely doesn't work? It makes both sides equal to each other. Three and one, 2 times 3, 6 plus 1 is 7. So 3 and 1, but we don't want to include it, so we'll put a little open circle. Okay? There's another one that just barely doesn't work. Makes both sides equal.
3 and 2.
3 and 2, 3 and 1 works, I would imagine. 3 and 2. Now 3 and 2 will work because it'll make it bigger than 7. Oh, we should include it. It's just that 3 and 2 actually is a filled in dot there.
3 and 3.
Okay, well, you're naming ones that do make the inequality true, but we're looking for that fence, for that barrier, for that. Okay, you cross this and you've gone into the points that don't work.
0 and 7.
0, yeah, 0 and 7. 0 times 2 is 0, plus 7 is 7. Okay, so this is one of those that's not going to work. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Put an open circle there. Do you see any patterns between the open circles?
Yeah, they're making
what's that?
They're making a negative circle.
Do you think they'll make a line if we were to draw all these open circles?
Yeah.
Let's get one more and see if that fourth one will also be in line with the three we have.
7, 0?
7,
0? Sorry,
that was wrong. Because we have to multiply by 2, right?
4 and 2.
Wait.
4. 7, negative 7.
7, negative 7?
Yeah.
7, negative 7. Let's see, 2 times 7 is 14. Minus 7 is?
7.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Put ourselves a little circle.
Look at that.
So it is making a line, right? Okay. So how do I draw this line, but then also tell you that this line is made of open circles, not closed circles?
Dotted.
Got it. That's a good choice. It really could be anything. It just depends on who decided, like who was the mathematician way back when, who decided this is the way it's going to be.
I don't know, somebody
but whoever it was
have not lived to make up this stuff.
That's yes, that makes it deserving of death or never having been born. I don't think so. So, like it could be, whoever decided this could have said, oh, let's make it a zigzag line. Let's Let's make it a swirly line. Let's make it a, you know, like a curly cube, or look like a really long pig's tail.
Yeah, let's make it interesting.
Whatever. It could have been anything. But they said to themselves, let's use a dotted line. The dotted line tells me
that's not.
It cannot be on this line. If it were, it would be like this, where both sides aren't equal, and that was fine. But here, it's not fine. It's not fine for both sides to be equal. One side has to be greater than the other.
Which doesn't matter.
So you see how inequalities work in two variables? There's this line where both sides are equal, and then there's the one side or the other makes them not equal in the right way, right? Makes the left side here greater than the right side. Where do you think those points will be? All the points that do work.
Above the line.
The above the line, just like they were before. We already have a few, so we can pretty safely conclude that the rest of them would be up there too. Okay. So now we see what it looks like to graph an inequality in two variables. It's all these points. It seems like it's even like so many more than are on a line. I'm not sure if there are more of them on the line or more of them over here or if it's the same. You think there's more on the line or more over here?
Numbers or
points? You think there are more points on this line?
So
what's that?
I think both go no. Differently, so that's confusing.
They both go differently, so that is confusing. So this just brings up an interesting question. That was interesting to me. I'm going to write some numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You guys see where I'm going with this? Have you caught on yet?
You're going up by one.
No, it's not that amazing. Go on forever, right? These are what we call the natural numbers, the counting numbers. Now I'm going to write down some more numbers. 1. 4, 9, 16, 25, 36, 49. Does anybody know what the next one is?
Hold on, give me a minute.
Doubling.
No, it's not doubling.
It's not doubling. This doesn't double. This doesn't double. This doesn't. None of these double.
Going by 3, then 6, right?
Goes up by 3, goes up by 5, goes up by 7, goes up by
11, 3, 5, 7,
goes up by 13, goes up by 15.
It's going up by like kind of 2 every time.
2 more every time.
Mm-hmm.
What would the next one be then?
Okay, so 3, 5, 7, 11, and then what?
You tell me? You told me
3, 5, 7, 11. Oh, God, wait. 14. 14.
Huh?
The not prime number.
14.
Well, they're not prime. That's a good observation.
14, 17, okay, then 20. Okay.
Well, this one you said
so
by
it would
three,
be, hold on,
5.
Would it be 69?
64.
64. God, that was close.
Does anybody see what these numbers, I mean, that is a pattern. That is true. That pattern does, it will get you all of these numbers. Can you see, though, what these numbers are? What kind of numbers these are?
Prime.
They're special.
Evens.
They're not prime.
No.
They're not all even. They're not all odd.
They're all open. They all have something to do with the number one.
Sure.
They're all mathematical.
It's true.
We'll be using these in life.
Okay, these are all square numbers.
That's the age I'll die.
Yeah.
Oh, I was so close. I can't see.
They're
all
what?
Going up by there. It was adding like 11.
But now, these are just the square numbers.
I mean, they're square.
1 is a square number, 4, like 2 squared.
3 times 3.
3 times 3, 4 times 4. And so on. So this would be, this 8 times 8, 9 times 9, 10 times 10, 10. 11 times 11, and so on.
Stupid.
Now, here's my question. How many of these numbers are there?
Infinite.
That's what these dots mean. How many of these numbers are there?
5.
Infinite.
They are also infinite.
Oh, that's stupid.
Are there more of these, or are there more of these?
There's more of those.
Which ones?
none. They're all even. Okay, there's infinite numbers. All even.
These aren't all even, and these aren't all even.
Oh my gosh, you're not some even. Okay. What I mean.
Oh, you're saying there's just as many of these as there are of
yes,
these?
Yes.
Why?
Because it's numbers.
Because they're infinite.
You can do one gazillion by one gazillion.
So
that is a prime.
Okay, so you guys misunderstand something about infinities. Some infinities are bigger than other infinities.
What? Are you joking me?
I'm not. Okay, space is not the same. It's the same as numbers.
Well, I don't know if it's infinite or not. Nobody knows where the end of it might be.
Apparently there's bigger infinites, even though they're both wrong.
There are bigger, some infinites are bigger than other infinites.
Well, we'll also have to,
I'm not really sure.
Now, you might think, like, well, there's fewer of these because, look, if I write out all these numbers, sorry, if I write out all these numbers, there's one, there's four, there's nine, right? So I've written out 14 whole numbers. I've only found three square numbers, right?
Right.
But you're right in saying that there's the same number because if I can count them, right, if for every one of these I can have one of these, then they're the same. There's the same number of them. Right? And I can count. There's the first square number, the second square number, the third square number, because this is 3 squared, and this is 4 squared, and this is 5 squared, and this is 6 squared.
And there's 6 squared.
Okay? So they're actually are the same amount. And sometimes you ask a question and people don't know enough to be as amazed as they ought to be. And this is just bad sometimes. Well, that's okay. Most people, if you ask them in like a number theory class or something, they'll say, well, there's more regular numbers because when I write them out, it already has all the square numbers in them and there's not as many. But there are things called countably infinite and uncountably infinite. There's an infinite number of square numbers, but there's a way to find the next one. There's a method to it. Uncountably infinite means there's so many. Anyway, let's look at some more inequalities in two variables. Let's try y minus 3x is greater than or equal to 4. Let's just establish a couple things we have already discovered. Okay? There's a line, right? Cameron, what do I mean by there's a line?
Well, there's a line.
When we think about graphing this inequality and I say, for one thing, there's going to be this line. What line am I talking about?
The line that's on the 4.
The line that's on the 4? That makes everything equal to 4. Right. Just like this, no, not this one. Let's just delete this guy. So there's this line, right, where everything equals 7. The x and the y together make 7. There's this one where the x and the y together make 5, right? And what Cameron is saying is that there's going to be a line for this one where the x and the y combine together and equal 4, right? Okay. So there's going to be a line, and then there's going to be, like, half of the plane that's, let's call it, shaded. Right, or blocked out, or covered by dots, right? Covered by points. So what I'm going to help you do is find that line more easily, and then help you do a test to figure out which half is it that I should shade in. Okay.
Yeah. What if you only have to find two of each to know that? Because then, like, if you just found like two that don't equal 4. Put like one here and then like one there, and just found two that do, like above. That'd just be the easiest way to do it.
Well, let's talk about that. So, let's find two that work, and that make this side greater than 4. So go for it.
Yeah, I was trying to talk about like seven and one.
Seven and one. So seven for x.
Oh, I'm sorry, not for x.
Okay, let's switch it.
One and seven.
1 and 7, so 7 for y, and 1 for x. Okay, now wait a minute. I thought what you were saying was, let's find two that make it bigger. You got two that make it equal.
Yeah, I'm just saying, like, you just need to, like, kind of be above. So you can do, like, 8-2 or something like that. It just needs to be slightly above the line. Or.
Well, is this going to be above the line?
Oh, you know what I mean when I say that.
Oh. It's just, like, the circle. I don't know how to explain it right. It's, like, in my hand, I get it. It's just, like, where the line is, it has to be, whatever you're trying to get,
yeah.
It has to be below it if it's, like, negative.
Uh-huh.
It has to be above it if it's positive.
Uh-huh.
You just need two circles, because then you can do a line with two circles. In fact, you probably just need one hole, like, that does equal it above that or below it, because then you know everything that above that or below that will also equal.
Okay, let's do this. Let's pick a point where this side's greater than, okay? So, definitely if I pick, like, 10 and 1, okay? Oh, sorry, I got it backwards. That time. 1 and 10. So y is 10 and x is 1. 10 minus 3, right, is 7, and that's bigger than 4.
Yeah.
So 1, 10. Branson, would you say that's a useful point?
Well, it doesn't have to. Like, it just has to be above the line. You'll, like, when you get. So, like, that will work. The line's drawn. Because you already have a dot there.
The line is already drawn.
That's what I'm trying to tell you. Like, you need the other two. Well, you need the line first,
okay.
And then once you do that.
You got it. I mean,
yeah.
You pretty much laid out our strategy. We need 2 points on the line to know where the line goes, and we need a point not on the line so we know where everything else goes. Exactly. So let's just make that as easy as possible. Right? We can randomly find points, like you found one already, that is, what did you say, 1, 7, right?
Yeah,
1, 7. We know that one, 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. We know that one is on the line, right? So we kind of maybe want to remember that one because that one's special. Cameron, can you give me another one that's on the line?
That's on the line?
On the line. And if you need to, like, you can make one, one negative. For x, 4 for y. Very nice. You just took this guy out and put a 4 there, and it certainly works. So 0, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. So this guy here are the two special ones Branson was talking about. These two are on that line, the line that makes this side equal to this side. So if they're both on the line must go like this, right? And forever in both directions. And it's a filled-in line, because it's okay if they equal each other. And there's a point right here above the line. So the rest of the other points that make the left side greater than the right side, they must be where? Over here?
No, I'm sorry.
Up here?
Yeah.
Above the line. I like above. Some people say to the left, but the way I'm going to show you today is much easier to think of it as above. We started that way, and so we're in good shape. So they're all above the line.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, not below the line. So what it takes is to find that line, and Branson's already come up with that idea. Find 2 points that are on the line, and now you'll know where the line goes through. Right? And the other half, right, we just need like a test point. We need a point that works. Okay. So to make that as easy as possible, let's do this one again, but I'll show you the way that I have it here. So we have y minus 3x greater than or equal to 4. Y minus 3x greater than or equal to 4. I'm just going to add 3x to both sides. And I'll have y is greater than or equal to 3x plus 4. Does that look familiar?
Yes.
What's it look like?
Looks like a problem off our line.
Looks like the reverse.
Looks like y equals
mx
plus b.
Looks like y equals mx plus b. Right? If y did equal mx plus b, then we graph that.
Okay.
We graph a line, right? We graph a line. So we'll graph that part the equal to part. And that's just as easy to say. There's our y-intercept, 1, 2, 3, 4. Here's our slope, up 3 and over 1. There's our line. Is that line okay? I mean, is it all right for both of the sides to be equal to each other in this case? They can be equal to each other, yeah. So we fill it in, right? It's not a dotted line, it's a solid line. And now, pretend we didn't know anything about the we've already done this graph, right? It's right here. But let's pretend like we haven't. We need to find a point that tells us we're on the right half, either the top half or the bottom half. So how do we find that point?
Do you use the x and y coordinates?
Yeah, like pick a point, x and y coordinates, throw them in there, if it works, and you found it. Let me just, on purpose, choose this point. What's this point?
0, 0.
0, 0. I'm gonna delete that, because I don't necessarily know that that's right. But I'll pick 0, 0. I'll just imagine that I'm gonna put a point there. If what? I'll put a point there if what? Is that? Well, it's definitely not on the line. It's right there, 0, 0. But if I go and I plug in 0 for y and 0 for x, right? I'll put a point at 0, 0 if what happens over here? Is that? So we can't just not get 4. Well, let's try. 0 minus 0 is 0. Is that? It's not either of those things. It's less than 4, right? So when I include this point, can I fill this point in?
No.
Is this a point that works?
No.
Are any of the points that work going to be down here then?
No.
Where are they going to be then? Okay, so even if we pick a point that doesn't work, then we know that half that doesn't work, and we then by default know that half that does work.
Yeah.
Look at that. Cool. So here's the strategy. My main strategy, put it in, right? Put it in this form. Put in y equals mx plus b. Graph the line. Test the point. Harvey?
So, did your daughter ever figure out the math problem that she was trying to?
I haven't asked her in a while.
Oh.
We'll see.
Okay.
So, we'll see.
It's kind of came.
I don't know how she speaks about it. She thought about it very long. I think she figured it out. The first day I asked her, we had been talking a long time, and she was clearly bored, so I let her go. All right. So put it in this form. I think that's a really helpful thing to do. Graph the line with the slope and the y-intercept, and test the point. And if it works, great. You found the half that should be shaded. If it doesn't, great. You found the half that should not be shaded. Shade the other side.
So win-win.
Win-win. Let's try 2x plus 3y is greater than 5. That will be nice. We'll make it greater than 6. Give it a try.
Okay, so remember my three-part strategy. Put it in this form. Graph the line. That's part of it, because you have to remember to do it either solid or dotted. Is it a solid line? Is it a dotted line? Is this going to be a solid line or a dotted line? You can tell right now.
Solid. It's going to be a dotted.
It's going to be dotted because
because
we don't want it to be equal, right? Like all the points that we would plot would be like open circles. Okay. And then we get a test point. And once we have a test point and it's right or wrong, we'll know which side we're supposed to shade. I guess that should be part of the same steps. Test point slash quote shade. Okay? Because shading is just the only way that we can possibly plot infinite points. That's the only reasonable way to do it. So first we'll put it in y equals mx plus b. I guess we'll put quotes around the equals as well. So that equals to y something mx plus b. We'll get y by itself. So how do we do that?
Subtract by 2x.
Subtract 2x. So I have 3y on this side now. Greater than. Greater than. Now 7. Negative 2x plus 6. And then? Y by itself?
You subtract 6 from each side.
No, I'm gonna get y by itself.
No. 2. You add 2 by itself.
I'm gonna get y by itself. Like, why? We're so
subtract
close.
Subtract 3 from each side.
But it's 3 times y.
Divide
by 3.
Yeah.
Y is greater than. We don't have to flip the sign, right? Because we divided by a positive, not a negative. But if we didn't divide by a negative, we can still flip that sign. Y is greater than negative 2/3 x plus 2. Divided this by 3, we divide this by 3. So we did it. Step number 1. Make it look like y equals mx plus b. What flavor is that? Okay, so we're going to graph it. Graph a line, right? That would be if we had y equals mx plus b, we would have a y-intercept of 2. I'm gonna be real picky here,
okay. But
you don't have to be. I'm gonna plot an open circle, right? Because it can't actually be equal to. Then I'll follow the slope. I'll go to the right 3 and down 2. The right 1, 2, 3, and down 2. That's gonna put me right here on the y-axis. An open circle. So that tells me where my line should be. My dotted line.
Okay.
Why is it dotted?
Because it's an open circle.
Because it's made of open circles, yeah?
That's so just an
because, well, they cannot be equal. The two sides cannot be equal to each other. And if they were on the line, as we discussed before, they would be equal. That's what the line is. The line is what x's and y's go together to equal 6. We don't want them to be equal 6. We want them to just give them to be greater than 6. That equals 6. Okay, now we need a test point. And whether that test point works or it doesn't is useful, right? Are we agreed on that? So I might as well pick a really simple test point like 0, 0 again. 0, 0. What's better than 0, 0? Nothing. I can test it here, I can test it there. Let's try it here. 0, 0. 0 is greater than 0 plus 2. Is that true? Is 0 greater than 2? It's not. So this is not the shaded half. And this is the shaded half. You see?
Oh, I see how that works.
Can
you go back a page real quick?
Back a page.
So do the zero trick on here.
Did it.
Oh.
0 minus 3 times 0. 0 is greater than negative, or greater than 4? No, it's not. Right? So it's not this half, it's this half.
Okay. So
yeah.
If it's true, then it's on the right side.
I would say the lower side is what I would say. I would say that it's below. If it is true, then it would be below, unless 0, 0 is above the line, and then it would be above. It'll never be both. It will be on one side or the other of the line.
Got
I thought you said, what if it's both? Okay. What's that?
Unless it's got curved lines.
We'd have to have two lines. We'll only ever have one line because we're just working with one inequality. We'd have to have two inequalities to have two lines. Okay. All right. Now, all the ones that we've done so far, it's always been above the line. Let me show you why. I like above because above is vertical, is y, correct? Y is vertical, x is horizontal. Y is vertical, x is horizontal. Notice this says y is what? Or greater, right? Where are greater y's? Where are bigger y values? Up there, right? Here's the line, that's where they're equal, and the ones that make the y, right, the vertical part bigger, are above the line. This guy here, same thing. Y is greater than the line. So there we go. It's greater than. It's above. The y values that are bigger are up, right? All the points that work are up above the line. this guy here is the same, this guy that we started with. If we were to rewrite it, we would get y is, we subtract 2x from both sides, we get y is greater than negative 2x plus 7. And again, y is greater than, right? So the y values are above the line. Above. Let's do one more together. See, I'll make it easy on us. Y is less than 3/5 x minus 3. Okay, so we're going to start by graphing what? Makes what shape?
Line.
Right. We're going to graph the line.
Oh, yeah.
And that line is a place where both sides of the inequality are what?
Equal.
Is it okay for them to be equal? No. But that is like the barrier. It is the fence between okay points and not okay points. So we do want to have it. So we would graph a y-intercept of negative 3. I'm being picky. I'm using an open circle because I know that that point does not work. It makes both sides equal, and, well, that's not okay. If you put a solid point there, I would not care. The important part is the line. I'll go up 3 and over 5 from there, up 3 and over 5, and put another open circle. That's not going to work. It's not going to make the inequality true. And then I'll connect it with a line, but what kind of line? A dotted line. Sometimes things are not perfect. It's like the same symbol being used in two different situations, it's like the same word meaning two different things, like this word. Right? It's like sometimes things run into each other and they don't make sense. Like, why is it that way? Why does this mean wind and wine? Why don't we just use different letters and have that mean that? So then we have to do what? Find a test point, 0, 0 works. The only time you're not going to use 0, 0 is when?
When it's...
The only time you'll not use 0, 0 is when it actually is on the line. If it's on the line, it's not going to do you any good because you already know about that point. It's on the line, which you already graphed. So pick 1, 1, 0, 1, negative 1. Like, I would make one of them. But yeah, just pick a different one. Make it easy on yourself. But they're 0, 0. We can use it. We can test it. So 0 less than 3/5 times 0 minus 3. 0 is less than negative 3. Is that true?
Yes.
0 is less than negative 3. 0 is greater than negative 3, right? Negative 3 is to the left of 0. So no, it doesn't work. So this is not part of the half that's shaded.
Right.
That's
good.
That half is blacked out by all the points where x and y make that equation, that inequality true. So, in your homework, make sure to. Sometimes it's. What's that?
Is it just 6.7?
Yeah. So. Sometimes it already looks like y equals mx plus b. Sometimes you need to make it look like that, but that's what I would say you could do. Okay. There's other ways to think about this. There's other ways to graph that line. There's other ways to find that test point. There's other ways that you don't even have to find a test point. You could just know which half is supposed to be shaded. But I found this to be the way that most people like it. But just as a quick note, I could tell this is the half that I'm supposed to shade because y is supposed to be less than.
So
less than the line, and y is vertical, and in the vertical, less than is down.
Right? So if it's less than, then it's below, and if it's greater or equal to, then it's above.
Well, if it's less than, it's below, it's greater than, it's above. If it's equal to, then the line is shaded in, the line is soft.
Oh, okay. Then no side at all. No side is shaded.
If it's just equal to,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
If it's greater than or equal to, now you know two things. The equal to tells me that the line is solid. And the greater than tells me that it's shaded above.
So I just have to look at the sign and tell me.
If it's written like this, yeah.
All right, cool.
If it's written like this, then less than is below, greater than is above. Equal to just tells me about the line, whether it's shaded or not. Whether it's solid or dotted.
All right.
So you can do that too. So test point or greater than is above, less than is below. As long as it's y is greater than, or y is less.